As we all know that the most important thing when we start our radiology practice and even when we practice later on are the stroke patients, and sometimes they can still be confusing even though the anatomy looks simple. So let's begin with this talk on cerebral vascular anatomy. So when we talk of the vascular anatomy, all of us know that it has to be arterial and it has to be venous both. So when we talk of arterial anatomy, it is mainly the circle of Willis when we are talking of intracranial vessels. So this is a routine TOF image, time of flight reconstructed image, when you see whenever you perform your MR angio for the brain. So here you can identify the components of circle of Willis. So this one is the middle cerebral artery. Here going ahead on this end-on view is the anterior cerebral artery. The internal carotid artery is the artery which is seen better on when you see the coronal sections or the sagittal sections. Here you have the posterior cerebral artery. Connecting the two, completing the circle of Willis, are the posterior communicating arteries. Similarly, anteriorly, we'll have the anterior communicating arteries. Here connecting the two anterior cerebral arteries. So in this way, there is a complete circulation overlap in the brain, so that whenever for some cause, if a vessel gets blocked, rest of the circulation can take care of it. So we all have seen a lot of cases where the patients have their arteries, like even sometimes the posterior circulation is showing thrombus, and then we see that the posterior communicating artery becomes very much prominent. So we have seen a lot of times that the entire ICA is showing no flow, but there is still flow seen in the MCS through the posterior communicating arteries. There are various anatomic variations, like we can have hypoplastic A1 segments of the anterior cerebral arteries. Whenever the posterior communicating artery is of a diameter which is bigger than the P1 segment of your posterior cerebral artery, so we will feel that it is as if continuing with the rest of the PCA. So then we call it as a fetal variant of the posterior cerebral artery. Same area when we are going to see in another anteroposterior projection, we are going to identify these anterior cerebral arteries. These are the middle cerebral arteries. So from their origin to the first division is the M1 segment of your MCS. Here is your anterior communicating artery, very common site of small or even large aneurysms. So here you have to look for these aneurysms. You may find that there is a patient with a lot of subarachnoid hemorrhage along the sides of these arteries, and then you can identify on your MR angio sequences based on where the magnitude of the blood is kind of maximum, that which area is the most suspicious for having these aneurysms. Sometimes because of the subarachnoid hemorrhages, the vessels are in spasms, so you may not identify the aneurysm. But when you perform your high resolution MR angios, so even with the 3 Tesla scanners now, with your TOF sequences, high resolution MR angios without contrast can identify aneurysms as small as 3 millimeters in size. But definitely post contrast MR angio or post contrast CT angio will be giving you more sensitive details of these aneurysms. So these are the smaller branches of your basilar artery, the posterior circulation, which is a part of your circle of Willis. These smaller branches may not be well identified on your non-contrast TOF angios, but the vessels which you can identify are your anterior inferior cerebellar arteries and your superior cerebellar arteries, posterior cerebral arteries. Pica, which is the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, is a branch coming out from the V4 segment of the vertebral artery. Same circle of Willis, including the communicating branches. So these images clarify the anatomy very well, and these are all our routine images which we see on radiology assistant or radiopedia sites. And here we can see that the horizontal part of the MCA from its origin till its division is called as the M1 segment. Then it takes a small turn and divides into the M2 segment, which has usually superior and inferior divisions. These are the cortical branches of your MCS. Here you can identify that the lenticulostriate arteries are arising medially from the ACA, A1 segment, while the lateral part of it is arising from the MCA. So when you are seeing the infarcts in these areas, that is the area of the thalamus, basal ganglia, internal capsules. These are the areas supplied by the lenticulostriate arteries, medially by the ACS and laterally by your MCS. The most important vessel intracranially, as we all know, is the internal carotid artery. And if we revise the parts of these this vessel, we know that there are 7 segments. So C1 is the cervical segment. C2 is the petrous, which comes near the petrous apex. C3 is the lacerum segment. C4 is the cavernous segment. C5, that is the tortuous area, is the clinoid. And the one after that is the supraclinoid. So basically, the cavernous segment is relatively easy to identify. We know where the site of cavernous sinus is. So it is a relatively vertical part of your carotid artery, just close to that. So that is your cavernous segment. Afterwards here, this tortuous segment is your clinoid and supraclinoid. The segment here that is marked as C3, as we call it, the petrous segment. So usually the petrous, the lacerum and the cavernous segment is taken together and named as petrocavernous for our general purposes on our reports. So most of the times we might get some irregular narrowing related to atherosclerosis in our patients. So another example where they have divided the DSA image of ICA into various segments. Now this is another important image that we try to refer to in our early residency days and later on kind of remember for our stroke patients. So whenever we are describing a case of stroke and infarct, we always tend to put few markers or few tags to our report. That is one, whether it is hyperacute, acute, subacute or chronic. We would like to tell whether it is hemorrhagic or non-hemorrhagic. And then we are going to tell them that which vascular territory is involved. We will perform MR angios and we will also tell them about if we can see a large vessel or small vessel occlusion. And our Swan images, we will identify the intravascular luminal thrombus. So here is the same image telling you the distribution. So midline parasagittal band-like areas are from ACS. Larger part of the brain, the one which is marked in yellow, is from the MCA territory. Posteriorly, even in the superior part, parasagittally is the PCA. So sometimes this can be a confusing part. Here is the area of basal ganglia, thalamus and the internal capsule. So we'll see that with another image in little detail. So same thing in a different manner, ACA, PCA and MCA. So you have your watershed zones. Most of the time in patients, you might have embolic infarcts. If you have some cardioembolic etiology, the infarcts will be distributed in different vascular territories. That time you can ask your concerned physician to correlate with the cardiovascular workup. You can have watershed embolic infarcts, and also if there is some kind of plaque which is unstable in any of these major vessels like MCA or ICS, you can have artery to artery embolic infarcts as well. So here you see the area of basal ganglia. The one which is marked in the pink color is the posterior limb of the internal capsule, very commonly seen, and the patient will have features of dense hemiplegia. So this is supplied by your anterior choroidal artery. Inferior sections, and when we start with the vermis and the cerebellar hemisphere, which we'll see in details with another image. So here is the area of your superior cerebellar artery. This entire midbrain by PCA and basilar artery will supply your pons. Anterior part, which is the hippocampus, is anterior choroidal artery. And if you have infarcts, even smaller infarct in this area, mesial temporal and hippocampal region, can lead to transient global amnesia. So even tiny infarcts of few millimeter size are important. If you see the 3D depiction in another orientation, we can again see the distribution of the arterial territories, and we can understand that MCA has a bigger contribution to the vascular supply. And then you have ACAs and your PCAs posterior. This is the image of the posterior fossa structure, that is your cerebellar hemisphere. This is again important and to know that what are the vessels which are supplying your cerebellum. So here inferiorly is the posterior inferior cerebellar artery. The area which is in gray here is the anterior inferior cerebellar artery, and a large part of the cerebellar hemisphere is by the superior cerebellar artery. If you perform a good quality TOF angio, you can identify smaller thrombus or smaller areas of occlusion and aneurysm even in these small vessels. If you perform a good quality Swan images, you can identify small band-like areas of blooming within, which will be suggestive of intra-arterial thrombus. So just a small revision again for this basal ganglia arterial supply, anterior choroidal artery in the posterior limb of internal capsule, penetrating branches of PCAs in thalamus. The ones are yellow in color are the lateral lenticulostriate from MCA and medial lenticulostriate from ACA. Just touching upon variants, so we know that fetal PCA is something which is commonly seen, but there are few more fetal variants which you can have. They are persistent branches of fetal origin. So here is an example and can be seen in our spotter section of the exam sometimes. So that is the persistent trigeminal artery. And similar to persistent trigeminal, which you can see here as a communication between the ICAs and the basilar artery, you can have few other types like the hypoglossal artery, the proatlantar intersegmental artery, otic artery. So these are all communication between your vertebral, that is the posterior circulation, and your anterior circulation, that is your ICAs. So these may be persistently seen and may look odd on your reconstructed angiograms. Sometimes they may be a little partially hypoplastic and then they can mimic aneurysm. So it's always suggested that you report your MR angios after seeing the raw data and not only the reconstructed MIPS. Another important variant is your artery of Perforon. So that is something which we all know, that when you have symmetric areas of infarcts, restricted diffusion involving bilateral thalami along their medial aspect, one of the most possible differential is that you have an artery of Perforon infarct. So this is another variant where both thalami are supplied by a single vessel, that is from one side, PCA. So this can be another classification. So people kind of classify everything almost. So they have classified artery of Perforon, but this one is something which is commonly seen, a single branch coming out from PCA and then dividing into two. So to summarize, there is nothing much to be said, but what is important is anatomy is something which requires revision, and there are a lot of variations in the anatomy which may create confusion sometimes. So we can always refer to our resources and references, and also look at the source images whenever possible for angiograms and venograms.